Two aspects here, which that kind of relates to. One is affordability, the other is acceptability. If things don't have a form factor that people will accept and that works the way they work, it may just stay on the shelf. So if someone were to design a catheter you could swallow that would monitor internal functions, well, they came up with something like this. It's not going to get picked up very well. And, you know, a company that would do something like this would probably not be around today. Not that they tried to do this, but, you know, that's just not an acceptable form factor. This is. This is pill cap. You swallow it. It takes pictures of the rate of 2 per second, goes all the way through your small intestine, shows the gastroenterologist if there's any lesions, where there's bleeding, and goes out the other end. That's M2A for reasons I won't go into. The reason was the trademark problem, not because of the duplications. But now they have them for the esophagus. You can swallow that. It takes 28 pictures per second because a swallow is a lot faster transit than small intestine. A different company called Smart Pill is making one of these, a similar device that actually does monitoring of gastric pH. You don't have to run around with a tube down your nose. They can monitor it on the fly, not just snapshots in time. So these types of monitors now exist. The form factor matters. If it works for you, a device that will monitor less physiological functions, it should be some form that would be acceptable to you. All you gotta do is wear this suit. Well, you know, you get kind of done this thing. It's called the open suit. It was developed at Virginia Tech. It's a prototype. It worked if they used their textile technology people to help with it. From Jeff Moore at lunch today was done with that. That was the fire station. Spent about a week in the first hospital, two letters to join, two want to read, and track them every step of the way and know what the condition is or what they can do those points once they've been in want to read for a week. So they've got this network and done greater in that sense. We have with a lot of people of diverse backgrounds, as I said, who all are interested in how products are accepted and picked up and used. is Michael Tchao, the general manager of Nike Techlab, a digital technology innovative group within Nike that develops new products and services and helps support and fitness customers. When you have the Nike Tech iPod, which sends data from the vendor sheet to an iPod and makes it available to upload to the internet, and Michael will give you a description of that. One of his responsibilities is to manage partnerships like the one that developing the iPod. And before coming to Nike, Michael's technology and marketing strategy for innovation for Philips, and before that was with Apple for 10 years. So product development, product marketing, and again, forming strategic alliances. And I thought in this area that we're discussing today, strategic alliances may be very valuable, so you can see a great view of those silos and see what's going on next door and where that's going. Next to him is Kevin Lee, I think. He built creative at Rockwell Group Experience Design. He founded a new collaborative studio Red dedicated to innovation for Coca-Cola for looking to design several products and programs. The studio now called Red also works for other major corporations. Tech background from Paddy Stewart, who's fellow of the Industrial Designers Society of America, and from Tech Lab, and some things by various publications and prestigious design societies. All of them laboratory. So this is the Nike Techlab program at the first floor of arts at NYU. And I'm sure we've all used products with top of top hand in design, and he'll focus on both. I'm very proud of what I'm going to tell you. Next is Morley Winograd. And I'm the director of the Center for Telecom Management at the Technology School of Business Services at USC. He's had a business around the network digital industry, has recent research programs within the business world that they have concepts, opportunities for the application of new technologies. He's also recognized authority on the impact of technology on life and work. He's advised governments on the referral ethics programs to USN internationally, and prior to ethics, he's lived in 18 years where he develops innovative approaches to corporate training, which he reached out to a university environment. He's also primarily invested in from a survey on consumer attitudes toward technology, which would help to inform the discussion on consumer attitudes with interest in telehealth applications. And in particular, he has some facts on the value of digital networks and so on. Finally, is Dr. Garry Neil, who is Corporate Vice President of the Corporate Office of Science and Technology at Johnson & Johnson. In this role, he leads a team that catalyzes the state of growth technology by identifying and launching emerging technologies that will be the foundation for the traditional future businesses. Just prior to his current position, he was Group President of the G&J Pharmaceutical Research and Development. And that's why he existed strong to leveraging the company's resources to be able to bring new drugs to market or develop new or expanded indications for a marketed drug quickly and cost effectively. Such indications include drugs related to cancer, renal, infections, central nervous system, and psychiatric disorders, pain, genetic, urinary, and gastrointestinal diseases. Before he was moved to J&J in 2002, he had positions at other pharmaceutical companies as well as positions at research institutes and universities. He's a gastroenterologist by training and has particular interest in pain medicine and geriatric issues. And along those lines, this year, the American Geriatric Society selected Dr. Neil to receive its Trivia Award in recognition of what he and J&J have done to make sure health provided for older adults. Let's get going on the panel discussion. See how we can design some physiological monitoring devices that will be acceptable or even desirable to the public and make them affordable. First, Kevin, you've been around with this design consumer products. Do you think some of the design and marketing principles that you've developed or really gathered in have application for medical monitoring devices? and just get them more hard and how they can do it.
How about if I show some pictures of that?
Why not?
You know, obviously, that's my idea. So, people do have good speakers. That, you know, that really makes me crafty. Because I worked on designing this with a smart design, and the idea was that we wanted to design a potato peeler for people with arthritis. So we started out by looking at the panels for that would be comfortable and useful for those kinds of people. So we made tons of different ones and worked with tested them out on people. And that's basically the same kind of thing that you do with medical stuff. The product that was really good for that people with arthritis could use it and made it up.
He used them usually too.
what survey was and who the survey did that file?
Thank you.
there's a lot of that. Or maybe we have to be dosed, and then there's dose conditions in individual patients. Maybe the time, maybe we didn't wait long enough to look and see an effect. Conditions of high quality metabolism, which differs in person to person, or the last study is that it could be an issue of compliance. So we know that that's a real big problem, even in a clinical trial setting. So the idea that you could have, just in pharmaceutical therapy, a marriage of technology that would allow you to really know who you're using somebody, so that does have some way of measuring. That would say that I'm not at this end therapy that's getting into the tumor in this particular case, like the titrate for that dose. I might be in that sweet spot where I'm just spending a lot of mass and toxicity. And we can end the condition. So this would allow us to really approach something that we all have to talk about, and we've heard something quite a bit about it today. Personalized medicine, so tailored therapy for patients. Is a real practical system. And because we know that we can talk about this, we can talk about pharmacogenomics, right? It's about people, which is not necessarily possible. But here, we don't have to be not necessarily downstream, we couldn't be successful in this particular case. We can just not be able to do it. And one of the things that we can do is that we can do it.
Well, I think I'm going to work with that. We can discuss it more later on. Which is monitoring compliance. And you'll get to mention that patient is not
A lot has also been said today about the financing of healthcare as an important driver for technology and innovation, and you can be moved to think about the benefit. Thank you.
Let me just get back to one of the things that Jeffrey Murray was talking about at lunch, which was this day the need to operate as a high quality market and be especially important to continue marketing experts. Another thing is a separate network-based effort, and it does describe how this whole system is not just because those people in the community.
Thanks. As I said, Monty Python now for something completely different.
I think this is the only conference I've ever spoken at. And I read it. But thinking about some big questions that would lead to some answers in this space. Could we turn information into motivation? Because Nike is at its core an emotional brand. Could we connect physical activity to what we saw was an emerging consumer behavior in digital networks and digital world? And also, of course, as any consumer product company is thinking about, how can we build a relationship with our consumer that goes beyond product into something deeper? So what that led to was us looking at a sport which we like a lot at Nike, which is running, and we saw a few things happening here. One is that running is an information-driven sport. The self-expression of running is really about knowing how far you've gone, how fast you're going, and how many calories you've burned. But what you may not know about running is the thing that's driving a lot of the growth in running is really a change in running from being a lone sport to being a social sport. On the right is an event we sponsor in nine cities in Latin America called Run Americas. It's the single largest running race on the planet. 60% new participants, 130,000 people this year. And one of a great source of energy for our consumers. The other thing that we saw happening in the running world was something that almost snuck up on us, which is that 3 years ago, Runner's World asked runners if they ran with music, and 25% of them said they did. Last year, 75% said they did. So really a tremendous change in running's behavior and the use of music. And when you talk about music, you can't not talk about this device, 110 million sold, you probably know that. What you may not know is that 50% of the most popular model, the iPod Nano, 50% of these devices are used in some sport or active pursuit. So we thought sport, music, maybe Nike and iPod, maybe we could bring these two together in an interesting way. So what I'd like to do in a few minutes is take you through the experience, because I think in order to understand all the bits and pieces and how they fit together, it's best to experience it the way a consumer would experience it. So there are three components to the Nike Plus iPod system, Nike Plus footwear, the iPod, and this thing called the Nike Plus iPod Sport Kit, which features a small wireless sensor about the size of a stack of quarters that fits in your Nike Plus footwear. And you simply insert it into the shoe like so, and then attach the receiver to your iPod. Again, a wireless receiver. When you attach it, it brings up the Nike Plus iPod menu, and that really unlocks the Nike Plus iPod world on your music device. Then really it's about picking a workout, picking a goal, and then selecting your music. So I'll go 5 miles here. And in this case, I'll ask the iPod to pick music for me. Then all I need to do is press the center button of the iPod to start my workout. So as I'm running, the sensor is actually speaking from the wirelessly transmitting information from my shoe to the iPod, and because I've chosen a distance workout, distance is showing large red numbers on the iPod screen, and additional time and pace. So you have that information available to you, but we want to make it really easy for the runner to get that information. So I'm going to have to. So, now, if anything like me, about a minute into it, you need that extra effort to get you going. So, press and hold the center button. Let's get it started in here.
This is Lance Armstrong. Congratulations, that was your longest workout yet.
It'll tell me each time I finish how I'm doing against that goal. In this case, it'll show me a little bit ahead of my goal to run that mile. Now, goals are motivational, but friendly competition is more motivational. So, we built a challenge functionality into the testing that allows you to easily set up challenges with your friends. So, now what I can do is I can name a challenge, set that up, send and email that information to my friends. And they'll be invited to that challenge. Then, after I name and send that out, each time any of us speaks to them, we'll see who's ahead, who's behind, or in this case, who's behind. So that's the next part of the talking part of the system. And 2 months ago, we launched this feature, which is the ability for you to focus the challenges to the IT customer. That people are participating in on an open source system, and the work that time could not attend, we decided to extend that event to a virtual marathon, the world's first virtual marathon, where people paid for, registered, and signed up to run
13.1 miles in their own backyard, in their own neighborhoods, to be a part of this community that we create with the Nike Women's Marathon. And we logged 3,600 folks who signed up for and ran 13.1 miles to be a part of Nike Plus. So I think for us, it really shows the power of this community and the ability to link the physical world with the digital world. So, you know, in quick summary, the three reasons why we're excited are, one, we're bringing together music and motivation. That's really powerful for the runner today. Secondly, we get to link physical activity to digital community, and that makes that activity more powerful and more pervasive. And third, and maybe more most important way for Nike, more people, more active, more often. That's really what Just Do It's all about. So that's Nike Plus.
So you're familiar, obviously, with the mind of the consumer, or at least with somewhat self-motivated ones to begin with. They get into running, no one's forcing them to. And you figured out what kinds of things, hurdles you have to overcome to make it even more attractive to these people. I think a couple of things you told me was easy to use, you know, battery can't fail too soon, or it turns itself on and off, the sensor, and also the sense of community, which is a big part of it. People who have healthcare problems are unwilling participants. So have you learned anything in how to motivate these people to motivate those people?
That's a great question. I think the reason why we created Nike Plus was really to go after those people who needed motivation. A lot of our products that serve elite athletes do serve folks who are motivated to run, who live to run, if you like to say. And what Nike Plus has shown us is that we can motivate people to go from either being inactive to being active, and we have great examples of that, or from being occasionally active to being more active. And I think any of us who registers know, if we're accountable to someone, if we're in a group or community, that's going to encourage us to participate more often. And so we hear all the time, hey, I wouldn't have run today, but I know that the person on my challenge team is running, and I can't let him or her win, or I can't let him or her log a run when I don't, so I'm going to go run today. And I think that's a powerful part of the win.
One thing that Dan Schultz said earlier was looking at things all the way through the process. Come to the FDA early. They will help you, you know, keep from getting into a bind and things like that. Tucker, one thing you've mentioned is sort of end-to-end integration. In this arena, you're going to have lots of players. You're going to have patients. You're going to have their physicians. You're going to have whoever's paying, whether it's the patient or the insurer. In designing any of these things in this arena, monitoring devices and the supporting infrastructure, you know, the doctor has to have a computer with the best kit, or a mount to the back, or something. Where do you start to figure out how to figure out the things to satisfy the constituents? Rather than just form a computer system that's not working at all.
Well, I think that, first of all, you have to, designers are interested, or designers like me are interested in designing things for people and for, it's called user-centered design. So I started designing for the, you know, the weak link in the thing, which is the obviously the patient. But I think you have to realize that all the other people involved are also using and different needs and different designs. And so, but if you design things with each one of those different things in mind, then, and you design it from their point of view, then theoretically, when you put it all together, it's going to be a success.
It's just that they each have their own centers of interest, and, you know, it's like a big, you know, Venn diagram. Can you get the circles to intersect, and how big an area to intersect is there going to be, really?
Well, all these different users are going to get different, you know. That insurer is going to get sick somehow and might have to use the thing. And we're all trying to make people feel better, so it's not like they're that much of a conflict.
The disruptions to cause major challenges with implementing not only technologies, but providing benefits to consumers. Michael got a description of that product, which was absolutely wonderful, starts with the iPod and says, well, we all know music is the iPod. Well, 3 years ago, you didn't think music was the iPod. And before that, you didn't think companies were the iPod. And then it's the iPod, and then
Well, I think that they have to start thinking like that. I think that, you know, if you look at cancer patients, for instance, they get a lot of strength from their other people who are sick, you know, so they create their own network. Why aren't the doctors involved in that? Why aren't the whole healthcare industry involved in that? That makes people feel better and get better.
I think they're enormous because, and we're starting to see again from a funding perspective opportunities to intervene. In other words, insurance companies and the payers might be willing to pay to keep people well. And we know, for example, we know a lot about the diabetes is a huge worldwide epidemic linked to obesity. We know a lot about how to prevent many cases of diabetes through lifestyle modification, and yet people don't do that. It's all really effective. How could we motivate them to use things like this? I mean, not to run a marathon, but to do something very important. Could they start to exercise? Other things in their life that are able to lose weight and avoid medication and complications. It's much cheaper to pay somebody or give them a plasma to do, for example, than to give them a kidney transplant because of complications with diabetes. So those sorts of enablers are very interesting. And again, as payers, as I understand, not being able to transplant them and the payers, but they can segment them. Well, and some of them are very, very motivated to do everything that they're supposed to do, but there's another segment that are not motivated at all, and that's like one that generally costs them more. So in certain diseases like asthma, like diabetes, like obesity, there are probably a lot of things that we could do, and that isn't really what I mean by that. One of them is people who do well under the injuries.
I love that idea of the insurance company paying people to stay well.
Speaking of Nike, we would be thrilled to have insurance companies pay for Nikes or for Dance Dance Revolution or Wii gaming systems that would keep kids healthier. Because if they're healthier, they're going to participate in sports more.
Don't forget, it's paying for an outcome, not for the
child. But with these systems, in terms of closing the loop, you'll be able to better monitor or track outcomes.
And you shouldn't make the assumption that altering behavior requires paying to do that. That's
we're certainly clear on that.
And they're still doing it, and it's the psychological benefit of computing and being a part of the community that's causing it.
Yeah, I think the point I was making was more that access to anything that has cost, there are many ways, as we talked about in previous panels, for that to be funded. And for some of for some of the people who don't have access to our products or other products, to have their insurance companies potentially help would not be a bad thing.
Some of what we've been talking about, or a lot of what we've been talking about, focuses on the monitoring going to a physician. It seems like certain things, especially in a preventive sense, could just go to the patient. I think we've discussed some of the
smart that could tell what the usual pattern of activity is at any given time, and if somebody's deviating a lot from that pattern of activity, rather than just wandering outside of a perimeter, maybe that's a sign that there could be some sort of intervention. But also, I think it's the same thing, which is how do you enhance compliance, safety, and wellness? But how do you empower the patients to be a bigger part of the healthcare solution? To keep themselves in a better state and therefore prevent certain bad outcomes.
You guys have a lot of some research shows that older people have balance problems, get some metastable, people they go to the sensors in both genes, have a little bit of a lot of ground or something, or, you know, sit down.
Well, I think when we look at monitoring, obviously we don't focus on the monitoring side of things. What we wanted to do is use the monitoring to drive motivation. So I think when we ask people, would you like to track your run, there are certainly a bunch of people who are really interested in that, the monitoring aspect of it. But what's more interesting we found is that once we provide that data and they can see, oh, I'm getting better, or one of our products, the most popular feature was the fact that it turned calendar days when they worked out well, so they could see that they actually worked out those days, and that was very reassuring. And so we're looking for the motivation of what really drives monitoring to the new level.
Morley, you mentioned the international perspective. Do people in other countries differ much from the attitudes here?
Well, there are some examples. Again, I refer to that. In this case, just tossed out an idea at lunch from Jeffrey Gore that perhaps one of the places to explore this future would be overseas and avoid some of the systemic challenges that the United States healthcare system creates. Stoffosis, the Netherlands, is very, very big in the telemedicine, a lot of different activities there, a lot of support and push behind it. Italy, which has a very aging population, is already deploying applications that focus on monitoring degenerative and chronic disease among the elderly, such as the wearable EKG test bands that that call the pre-programmed number on the cell phone automatically if it detects an emergency situation. Over in Korea, which has made a national focus out of introducing digital technology to the populace, and now ranks, if not first, way ahead of us in the use of these technologies. Beyond the relatively useful devices, there's, as inevitable with technologies, some toys out there as well, digital pill boxes that recite to you what the prescription is, kind of silly stuff like that. But there are very clearly applications of ideas in this field that are already in the field, to put it really, overseas. And the United States, as is often happens in this world, is in third place.
Thank you. We've got recommendations of things that might be practical means by which we could get acceptance of any of these physiological monitoring technologies in particular constituents.
There's a very strong linkage between what we're doing for
A couple of thoughts.
First, as you understand, we really much of that we have to pursue this. We realize it's venture capital growth and decided to be too much chosen to capital. But I think one thing that we've spoken to is that the market is fairly low and it's very competitive. It's an indication of the thing that's capable of doing the investigation. And it's oftentimes a capability of the patient.
And realize that you're talking about networks, I think it opens up a vast opportunity for people to think about the collection of data about healthcare. 25% of the content on the internet today is health related, and that's not because doctors have been putting it there. So you might want to think about, we really are in the communications network business, and when we do that, and think of it in those terms right from the beginning, and move away from the body that's the source of this focus, but rather the communications and networking of the data, you begin to open up enormous possibilities for improving healthcare simply through data mining and other patient-centered uses of network-transported data that's collected and mined.
Well, first of all, I think that that these things can be toys, and I think that if we look at the things that being fun to use, cool, and all those things, then they're going to be much more successful. The second thing is I think we should really think about the third wheel as being like maybe where the money comes from. And the third wheel is not the doctor and the patient, it's the other person who's trying to make sure that the patient is doing what they're supposed to do. So if my mother's sick, I have to make sure she's taking her pills. So I'm going to be willing to pay more money for some kind of communication with her than either she or the doctor. You know, especially if I'm living in New York and she's in Ohio or something. So I think that there's a lot of opportunity, you know, because of the distances between people and the technology.
Well, obviously you have a little bit different perspective, but from our standpoint, make it really easy to use, to leverage existing behavior. Secondly, make it fun and engaging so people want to do it. And third, you know, make it social because you connect the pieces together. The people that are going to be most motivational are the ones, as Tucker said, who have the closest personal connection with the person receiving care.
Any questions?
Nike and Apple have done a great job at actually pushing something all the way through. But it feels like
sounds like a study for doctors congratulating themselves.
Get there in the device side before too long.
we have a model that's completely broken. Go back to what Jeff was saying. I mean, to the extent that we have broken processes that don't work, and the discovery engine is so non-productive right now that it just does not justify the large expenses that we are doing now to collect evidence. And I'm really worried about that because we are facing a public health crisis, not just in this country, but around the world as populations age. We have all these chronic diseases to manage. So how are we going to be able to do that and develop tools to be able to help us make sense of that data?
First of all, I think it's an experience in an earlier life with FDA. You have to first tip your hat to that agency before it's going to engage with the industry and look for new solutions and new processes. However, they might take a more aggressive stance in suggesting that there are some alternative processes altogether that you just alluded to before, figuring out how to bring more saving or at least medically beneficial technologies to market through the use of data in substitution for some of the current processes and trials seems to be a major opportunity in the current state of technology. However, the medical profession, and that includes device manufacturers, you also have to be doing just their things. You have to give everybody their own electronic version of their medical records completely. And ask them how many of them want to participate in a patient-driven test of a device that the FDA would monitor for safety. And if you can invert the entire system in order to focus it back on the patient, you'll be approaching what's going on in social networks and other industries we've talked about, where it's no longer studio broadcast content that anybody cares about. It's user-generated content. In this case, it's patient-generated content. And if you can break through the mindset that suggests patients somehow isn't entitled to do anything about themselves and operate on a more logical basis than if they're there to begin with, you might find opportunities to break through what people in the industry term fundamentally do nothing about.
And just to add to that, because so now we have the FDAAA legislation, supposedly the FDUPA legislation, I don't know if a better way to say it, FDAAA, but which mandates the creation of a database with 100 million lives in it to be able to do drug safety surveillance. And presumably that will all be anonymized data coming from insurance providers, maybe from some government sources like Department of Defense and the VA. It's not clear at this point. But when you have such a large amount of clinical data for safety surveillance, it seems to me to be a terrible waste to not start to look at some of the issues of related to efficacy and benefit. It also seems to be impossible for us to make any realistic consideration and decisions around risk without considering the benefit or what happens within the natural history of certain illnesses. But all of this is going to, in my mind at least, require a lot of investment in a lot of new sophisticated methodologies to try to look at these data and try to make sense of it that we don't have.
And the methodologies have to be designed with understanding the pace of innovation. I mean, the notion that you would take years and years to develop a device before you can bring it to market in the IT community is laughable. You don't have that kind of time by the time you bring to market the technology that it's due. Once upon a time, the government used to buy the technology that way, and everybody had the very worst and oldest technology in the world in the world of the government. But people figured out different procurement practices that allow now most government workers to acquire technology quickly and with most leading-edge capabilities. So the same kind of reform has to take place in this industry as it approaches the question of going to market approval and sustainability.
Yeah. That's true. That's true. That's true. That's true.
Thank you.
But I think the bigger issue is like how maybe this whole kind of testing of the wrong idea. Like, what's interesting to me about the internet is that when you publish things on there, it's not final. You know, you put up a web page, and then it's like the first day. The next day, you go, oh, I misspelled this word or that word, and fixed it. You know, so I think that we have to maybe think about, you know, medicine in the same way. It's not like one day it's all going to be figured out. I don't think it is.
Oh, dear. I had a question for Tucker regarding the designs. You know, having put in the flammable devices for 15 years and looking at the interfaces now on the network, but before the program, you know, half the employees of these companies are engineers, and, you know, I've gotten to know them really well. They're very complex technology. I love them and I hate them. I mean, they're not designers.
So that complex.
But I've shown you some of the interfaces and how they think, and every, it seems to me in my mind is that many of these things are designed like a space shuttle. You'll have 15 ways to show the one set of data. It tends to be very iterative, but it's not, none of it's particularly user friendly. So your answer to the problem is less designed. It tends to be, let me just jump to 15 ways to grab the data. And as I mentioned with the website, it's not just your thing, it's the problem.
Well, first of all, there's plenty of things for improvement. But what's interesting is to have that there are all those different kinds of options for how to keep the data. It's probably putting it all out there, but it should, I think that the doctors should be able to pick which kind of way they want to see the data, and then comes up that way that it's clear, you know, makes the point, and maybe the patients get to look at it a different way. It's the same information, it's just translated in a different way for the different viewer. But I think that's the beauty of digital technology. You can fairly easily program it and come out one way or another. You can make it turn into music, you can make it, you know, be a, well, you can't make smell yet. It still has to be clear, and I think that, you can make data look like it means one thing and it means another, but I think that the idea is to make it look the way it needs the most to you. So you can see that, I better not do that now. Quickly, you don't have to read to the file or whatever.
I think from a user's interest in the stuff, that's happened to know that we've done under consumer, they will fail. They will tell you that the complexity of the customers will be the stuff that you're best
with.
How do you
does all of that flexibility and durability because you know that no patients are left as well. Just the patient of the patient and have that flexibility otherwise just addressing those and yet cardiac symptoms. So there's a very significant challenge that and to the comment that Morley brought up, we have gone away from having engineers to look at how we design injured patients who have people, backwards people, who are trained in taking a look at how people interact with the treatment. And we are at the beginning of a long journey for that, but that's something that's already made some significant progress for us. And then as we talked about patients and making the data available to them, I'll return the paper and ask a question here. As a physician, how much of the data are you comfortable with getting patients? Because that's the big question that we have as a design company, because fundamentally we're designing for our customers. And so we don't want to create anything that's more complicated or creates more work for our customers. And the big question that we have is how do we bring the patient into the well, the question for us is who selects our products? And the patient, I think, is a very important stakeholder. And this gets back to the point that Garry was bringing up and Jeff was bringing up at lunch. You know, it's a very interesting industry that we're in because the consumer is not the decision maker, the decision maker is not the payer. So we have significant misalignment in the industry that we may not have in other industries, consumer industries. So as we take a look at all of these different stakeholders and say, you know, what is their role in how we design products, it's a very very complicated thing for business to take a look at.
Yeah, I'm just going to say somebody else, David Hayes, is cardiology here, and guy puts a lot of advice in the thought for patients. David, how do you feel about your patients having all their own information?
I think if it was presented correctly and fine, we certainly would have to be completely, it would have to be digested in a completely different way from the patient. I don't have a problem with them having the information, but they have to be enough information there that they know what to make of what they're seeing. Otherwise, you know, we've seen it as we've gone through even some of the recall and advisory patients, they're not given enough information to jump to a lot of conclusions. So I'm fine with them having the information. And I think that in some ways would make our lives much easier. But I agree with you entirely that even the way it's presented as a position, which is presenting it more ways, doesn't make it better.
The challenge
is
taking a complex
product
and multiple information and presenting it in a way that you're using this has been solved in many places. And the most recent example is somebody kind of figured out how to give you a cell phone that you can understand. It's called an iPhone. And it's actually a more complicated product than most of cell phones. But the user interface makes it simple to use. So I wouldn't rest the problem on the guy like Chad. That one can fix the corner all to one.
But I'm sort of in that camp, and I'm very much of the mindset now. I've been a physician for a lot of years that the patient really has to be in this. And when I say patient, I mean that the patient caregiver is complex in many cases because the decisions are being made by family members. But empowering them and giving them tools that they can use and data in a way that they can make sense out of it is what we have to do, and it's also what FDA has to work with us to be able to do. Because right now, the benefit, risk, and what happens if you don't take this, what are your other options? It's harder for them to access that. When I go on talking to advocacy groups, that's their number one complaint, is that there's an enormous amount of data out there, but I can't find it in any one place in a way that I can easily use it. So I have to spend hours and hours and hours research to try to get there, and they're asking for help, which I think ultimately is going to have to come from somewhere, but that will lead through Washington and FDA because they have to communicate this. but we're putting all of our data now on the internet for everybody to see file orders or just be combing through it. People are trying to make sense out of it. And it's not really addressing the issue, it's not in a user-friendly way. But I think when you give people that, they can make those decisions and they can work with their physician. There's also enough information out there about how to handle that there's funding practices for the end from. So I think it's one of those things. Yeah, if you talk about privacy, everybody always says that they're very concerned about privacy, and yet they go down to Kroger's and give away all of their personal information for 2 cents off of $3. So in individual cases, people are very willing to sell their privacy quite cheaply. And I think, again, if you have the right incentive built into the system, why those data would be useful to you and return a benefit to you, I think people would be willing to be able to do that. And the benefit is health or lower insurance costs or whatever, all that together. We're just bringing them at the table. So I think, there are lots of barriers to being able to implement, but this is technology which is really right to implement and could in many ways that answer that we can go to a little bit because I have such a tremendous pain that I do. Then I think this is the right time to be able to implement. You simply have to figure out what are those tangible, non-pleasant things that we can do with it. And so I've got to use those ideas and ready for what we're running and then start to implement stuff. And I think FDA and a lot of policy makers are struggling to do because we have a provision of your program. We have to start. And there's always a mechanism that we can do that. We don't expect this sort of that we could make that wouldn't pay off when you think about having to address millions of people in nursing hospitals and all of the people with diabetes and on to almost no investment that would be 2 months that wouldn't give us the possible payback at that society. And that would also be the sweet spot of correlated with it, with
with itself, so that you could find out if taking two aspirins a day had any effect on your other kind of medication that you were taking, you know, those kind of issues.
Well, the first thing you have to do is really create a trust with the clinical practice that allows insurers to discriminate in healthcare policy issuing based upon pre-existing. As long as that becomes part of our system, there isn't a brain in the world that's trusted enough to give that up. But if you moved into a world where that wasn't the case, when individual mandates or whatever that obviate the need for that particular insurance practice, then I think brands in the healthcare industry with a high degree of trust, one of them is sitting to my right, have an enormous opportunity in front of them. J&J is what everybody grew up with and everybody trusts, J&J.
I didn't want to appear self-serving. But that's, you know, we have our site, for example, baby.com, which you might have heard of, which is 85% of the mothers in this country get their baby advice from that website. So I think that we have talked a lot about that in terms of what we can do to help to advance this. But it could be kind of a baby, right? But it's exactly what you say. The reason that people are nervous about it is the negative consequences of that. If you can turn that around into something which is more positive and moderate than negatives, then I do think many people would want to do that. If companies didn't know how to do this, people go out and do a health profile and score their blood pressure and cholesterol and other simple things. They get piling on about their own feelings. And then, once that happens, they get an intervention. The reason that we do it, the reason that other companies do it, is because even though we use an insurance carrier to manage the system for us, we're essentially self-insured, as most big companies are. So we're actually paying for the healthcare of the employees, and that $5 million incentive pays off more healthcare costs for our employees and their families.
Really, the next step with the management of the information of a person's health records, assuming that we can get around issues of privacy, issues of disclosure, issues of, you know, encoding, encrypting, et cetera. As far as that, where we should have, what we should be able to do is to amount of information on each person, especially kind of the conception of preventive medicine based on genetic proclivities and tendencies. And all of the devices that we've all referred to today seem to be something like a PDA. And it seems to me that there's a much larger body of information that really goes along with each person's medical records that, as Morley pointed out, everybody should have their medical records in some kind of mobile, accessible, centralized place, either in a device or equipment or in a centralized database. And I really think that the company or agency is able to mobilize that of memory is going to be the stakeholder and things like that. And I'm just wondering if you guys can speak to what you anticipate as the future of that idea. Do you agree that it's really an information management proposition?
All of the most recent medical records, and also send it to myself in my Gmail account, which accessible anywhere on earth that has an internet connected. So you can do it yourself, but as to the point of, you know, centralizing it, what do you think as a
well,
brought up a number of really important issues with respect to privacy, and a lot of that has also been solved in the banking industry. So you can, you know, access your accounts anywhere in the world with a card and ATM. So technologically, I don't think it's such a leap. As far as the storage goes, somebody that I know fairly senior at Google told me that their biggest cost in maintaining storage isn't actually on this drive of servers they have, it's the air conditioning to keep them cool. So the cost of storage is probably not the biggest issue for being able to do it. There are huge standardization in some electronic medical records. There's a bunch of companies out there competing one with the other to sell electronic medical records. Software, the doctors, I think they probably some sort of leadership from the federal government to maybe force some standards around that that might help them. But then you brought this up, Tucker, the wheelchair and the events there. You actually have something called the iPad, I don't know if you know that, which is richer than climate there, for the very reason that you said you can either change the world or you can come up with a device that helps people navigate that world. Maybe there is a software solution that will be able to deal with data in all kinds of different formats or try and force a 40-minute standard that might never happen and wouldn't let you get back and look at all of the legacy data that we already have. So I think there might be solutions to this. It's going to take some leadership and some will to do it, and probably some again, back to the financial drivers that kind of people want to do it.
Let's wrap up with that, and I think
Thank you.